Right hand up. And in 3, 2, 1, begin.
Soft purple walls,
lacy white curtains.
Assessment.
Today, I am a girl.
Observation.
A sizable walk-in closet dedicated just to shoes.
Assessment.
A fashionable girl.
Good morning, Vanessa.
I say, trying on my voice for the day as I check out my new self in the mirror.
First order of business.
Figure out who I am today. I can access this person's facts, but not their feelings.
This is my room.
But does she like it?
David and Linda are my parents.
But would she gladly kill them both in their sleep, given the chance?
It's impossible to tell!
My feelings and my memories replace those of whoever's life I'm borrowing from. So, to keep it simple, let's stick to the facts.
Every morning,
I wake up with someone different, and spend just 24 hours living in their life.
Never the same person twice!
But always still me.
Because of this, I've tried to
disconnect!
To not define myself in terms of anyone else. With 16 years of practice, I don't really make mistakes anymore. Until I met Rhiannon.
Every Day by David Levithan. Day 5,992. Observation.
T-shirts and boxer shorts everywhere. Far more video games than books.
Assessment.
I'm definitely a boy today.
Observation.
A stale, gummy taste in my mouth.
Assessment!
A smoker. Really, Justin? Cigarettes? Sometimes you just know it's not going to be a great day.
Good morning, Kitty Gangsters! I'm your host, BJ Jefferson.
And I'm Kitty Jane.
And you're listening to 96.9 Party FM. Hey, what's the traffic looking like?
Don't take I-97 because y'all...
get wrecked!
Oh!
His obnoxious choice in radio station is all I need to know about Justin, really. I access his memory for the facts.
The way to school, his parking space, who he knows in the halls, which locker it is.
I don't always have the energy to go through the motions like this, but today I'm up for the challenge.
Hey, Justin.
The girl standing next to Justin's locker is transparent in her sadness. His girlfriend,
Rhiannon.
Hey, are you okay?
I see the surprise on her face, even as she tries to hide it. This is not something Justin would ask.
Are you mad at me?
No. I'm not mad at you at all.
Which I know is what she wants to hear, but she doesn't trust it.
Okay. Do you still want to get lunch today? The easy thing would be to say no.
Which I do a lot. Sense that the other person's life is drawing me in and run the other way.
But there is something about her that's different.
Actually, let's go somewhere right now.
Let's skip out on class?
Yeah, come on. Where do you want to go?
I am breaking all of the rules I've set for myself.
Don't interfere.
Don't get involved.
Don't connect.
I guess. I want you to take me to the ocean.
Good afternoon, Big Day.
And my
ocean.
subconsciously melts away makes us all seem okay. I know I can't solve anyone's relationship problems, but maybe.
The rules can be erasable. For today.
Justin, come put your feet in the water.
I see her spinning, picking up sand, smiling so broadly. And I remind myself to take this all in.
This has to be one of the best days ever.
Tell me about another day like this.
Okay. In fourth grade, I signed up for this mother-daughter fashion show. I didn't ask first, but even though my mom was terrified, she didn't say no. They let us choose our outfits. I chose this super girly gown, ruffles everywhere.
I never let people tell me their stories. Because I know that if they do, they'll expect them to be remembered, and I can't guarantee that. But with Rhiannon, I can't resist.
That whole night, Mom just kept smiling and saying how great I was, and Dad thought we were nuts, but he went along with it, calling us supermodels and laughing like crazy. And that was it. I guess it reminds me of today because it felt like a break from everything. Now you, tell me about a day like that.
I don't know. I was never in a mother-daughter fashion show before.
False!
I've actually been in several.
No, a day like this one.
Okay. So I was 11, playing hide-and-seek in the woods with my friends. I broke off from the group and decided I wanted to climb a tree.
I don't think I'd ever climbed a tree before. But I found one with some low branches and started moving up.
And up, and up, and up.
Until I was above the tree line. Up there, it felt like I had made it somewhere special. I got to watch over the world, and I guess that was exactly what I needed.
Do you remember our second date? Back then, it felt like you would climb the tree and found me there at the top. Lately, you're always in a rush. I just wish we could have more days like this, where we're connected. Yeah. I'm sorry. Please don't be mad.
I promise. Nothing could make me mad right now.
When I drop Rhiannon off, I try not to think about what will happen next. But when she asks...
Can we do something tomorrow night? Something like today?
I know I can't make a promise that Justin won't keep.
I don't know. My mind's not really on tomorrow.
Fair enough. Let's just end today on a nice note then.
I have a routine I try to follow every night. Open my email, journal about the day,
and most importantly...
Clear the browser history! Leave no trace behind!
But tonight, I break the rules again and send myself Justin's email password too. I'm haunted by the fact that tomorrow Justin will be here and I won't. For the first time in a while, I close my eyes and wish to stay.
Day 5993. Observation.
Leslie Burns, open this door right now. You are so grounded.
There's no getting back to Rhiannon today.
Day 5994. Observation.
Skylar Smith isn't going anywhere.
The observe and assessment team has gotten old. As soon as I wake up, there's only one thing on my mind.
5,995.
How far am I from Rhiannon?
5,996.
Do I have a driver's license?
5,997.
How can I kidnap my host body today? The days without Rhiannon blend together until...
Day 5,998.
When I wake up as Nathan Daltrey.
A nice guy with no plans for Friday night.
I open up my personal email. Journaling about the past few days so I remember them. Then, out of boredom, I check Justin's email, and I find an invitation.
Master Ranger at Steve Mason's house!
I get the sense that Nathan's kind of party is more...
Dr. Pepper and Porking!
Yahtzee!
Nah.
Heads and dancing!
But I can't pass up the chance to possibly see Rhiannon again. I love that TV. Rhiannon.
Do I know you?
No, but hi, I'm Nathan.
Rhiannon, do you know what's like?
I'm just here for the weekend, visiting my cousin, Steve. Can't stand him, though, especially the way he treats girls.
Yeah, he's not my favorite. He must not be terrible, though, since he and Stephanie have been together for over a year.
That doesn't really matter, does it? People stay in bad relationships for all kinds of reasons. Fear of being alone, or the irrational belief that he will finally change.
Wait, what do you mean he? Are you?
Yeah, is that cool?
Completely.
Rhiannon, have you seen Stephanie? Steve's looking for her. I think they're fighting again. Who's this guy?
This is Nathan. Don't worry, he's gay. Nathan, this is Justin, my boyfriend.
Nice to meet you.
Maybe Steph's in the basement?
Nah, everybody's dancing down there.
Oh my god, Justin, let's go dance!
Not on your life.
Fine, then can I go with Nathan?
I hate that she has to ask for his permission.
Are you sure he's gay?
I'll sing you show tunes to prove it!
No, smoke can.
Had some Rhiannon is meeting me in the Steve Mason spaceship, where we can dance and talk for what feels like hours.
And also no time at all.
Till the music stops abruptly.
Can we stop emails? I'm heading home tomorrow, but this is an awesome day. We should stay in touch.
I had a great time. Too bad you're gay.
It's only once he's gone that I realize how late it must be.
11:15.
Poor Nathan Dalton.
11:20. 70 miles an hour.
He's going to wake up on the side of an interstate, an hour away from home.
11:35. 80 miles an hour.
I can only imagine how terrified he'll be.
11:45. 90 miles an hour.
11:50. I pull over and close my eyes. I'm a monster for doing this to him, but I have my reason.
Day 5,999.
Margaret White needs to work on her homework today.
Which gives me the perfect opportunity to set up the dummy email address I gave to Rhiannon.
To Rhiannon94@yahoo.com. From NathanD23@gmail.com. Subject, the party.
Dear Rhiannon, it was lovely meeting you and dancing with you last night. Even though you're not my type gender-wise, you're certainly my type person-wise.
Sincerely, Nathan. To NathanD23@gmail.com. From Rhiannon94@yahoo.com. Read the party.
Nathan, I'm so glad you emailed. Last night was a blast. I hope you get to Steve again soon. You're my type person-wise, too.
Love, Rhiannon.
Day 6,000.
Roger Wilson faked a migraine and stays in his room. Hoping to hear from Rhiannon again, I load up my fake Nathan email in one window, but there's nothing new. So I load up my personal email in another, and
28525246@gmail.com from NathanDaldry@gmail.com. Subject, warning.
I don't know who you are, or what you are, or what you did to me yesterday, but I will not let you possess me or destroy my life.
I must not have cleared Nathan's browser history.
I have given the police this email address. Don't think you can get away with this!
The police? I quickly Google Nathan's name and a news item comes up, dated this morning.
The devil made him do it!
When police officers found Nathan Daldry, 16, sleeping in his vehicle along the side of Route 23 early Saturday morning, they had no idea the story he would tell.
Drugs? Alcohol?
No, Daldry claims he must have been possessed by a demon.
It's like the whole day this thing was in charge of my body. Maybe drive to a party in a town I've never been to.
To make matters more mysterious, Daldry says that when he returned home,
someone else's email was on his computer.
If anyone else has experienced this before, I want them to come forward. I can't be the only one.
This has never happened to me before.
Apparently, Steve does not have a cousin named Nathan. Care to explain?
I demand an answer.
I'm at a crossroads. On the one hand, it would be so easy to run away from this, but
running from Nathan means running from Rhiannon.
I don't deliberate. I don't weigh my options. I just type and hit send.
Rhiannon.
I can, indeed, explain. Can we meet up at the coffee shop on Clover Street? It's the kind of explanation that needs to be done in person. Love, Nathan.
Nathan.
I am not.
Day 6001. Megan Powell.
It's not, of course, who Rhiannon's looking for, so she's a little startled when I come over to her table and try to sit down.
I'm sorry, that seat's taken. It's okay. Nathan sent me. Where is he? I need to tell you something that's very, very strange. You might want to laugh. You will probably definitely want to leave, but please let me finish.
Okay. Every morning, I wake up in a different body. Today, I woke up with Megan Powell.
Wait, what are you? Last Friday, it's Nathan Daldry. You're kidding me, right? And last Monday, it was Justin, your boyfriend. That was the first time we ever met, and I haven't been able to forget you since. Did Justin put you up to this?
No, I wanted to tell you the truth before I switch again, because I don't want to keep meeting you as different people.
I want to meet you as myself.
Tell Justin? He really sucks.
In your heart, you know it wasn't Justin with you on the beach that day.
That's because it was me.
Stop, this is insane.
What if we meet again tomorrow at the same time in the park across the street? I won't be in the same body,
but I'll be the same person.
Couldn't you just tell someone else to come?
I guess you'll have to trust me.
I'll give you tomorrow.
Thank you.
Don't thank me till I show up.
Day 6002. Observation.
James appears to be a football player. A big one.
Assessment!
Oh my god.
It's probably a good thing we're in a public park.
It's still me, I promise. I barely said hello before the interrogation begins.
First,
what song did you sing along to on the way to the beach?
I wanna dance with somebody. You're a great singer.
Don't flatter her.
Second,
what did she say to you before she went inside for the night?
Let's just end today on a nice note.
Okay, but
what did Justin say when you offered to sing show tunes at Steve's party?
Gross, go dance.
Well, that checks out.
What's your name?
James?
Not today, I mean, your real name.
No one has ever asked me this before. And I've certainly never offered it.
A. Justin. A.
Okay, A. I'll admit you have me actually thinking that you are, in fact, the same person who I've met now in four different bodies. All this means is that I'm probably insane.
You're not insane. You're the only person who has ever made me want to stop living my life this way.
Don't! You've only known me for a week. I need time to understand this, okay?
For now, this is more than enough.
This is the trap of having something to live for. Everything else seems lifeless.
All of the rules that gave my life order are gone.
Finn Taylor blows off work to take Rhiannon to dinner.
Sally Swain skips class to meet Rhiannon at a bookstore.
Lisa Marshall cancels the date with her boyfriend to go bowling with Rhiannon.
I know I'm interfering in these lives in ways I promised myself I never would. But I'm learning that a life isn't real unless someone else knows its reality. And I want my life to be real. Even before I open my eyes, I know that
Kelsey Cook's mind is a dark place.
Her mind is an unquiet one. Words and thoughts and impulses crashing into each other. I try to remain calm, but I'm drowning in the distortion.
And the desire for pain.
I access her history, and I'm shocked to realize she's gotten this far without any notice, any diagnosis. She's been left to her own devices.
And those devices are broken.
Kelsey, it's time for school. You're late again.
The black cloud of Kelsey's depression makes the thought of moving through the day impossible.
I'm too tired, Mom.
Can I stay home today?
No, get dressed.
I really don't think I can make it through school.
This is ridiculous. Fine, do whatever you want. I don't care.
She needs your help.
I want to scream. But it's not my place to sing, so I let her leave me alone with Kelsey's number one enemy, her brain's chemistry. The journal on Kelsey's nightstand calls me, and when I flip through the pages, I realize.
Kelsey Cook has methodically researched an extensive list of ways to kill herself.
There's a page near the end that simply reads,
deadline,
with a date that's only 6 days away. I try to access any memory of Kelsey giving a cry for help.
But the thing about a cry for help
is that someone else needs to be around to hear it.
And I'm not finding a moment of that in Kelsey's life.
Rhiannon.
I don't want to scare you, but the girl whose body I'm in wants to kill herself. Please, call me.
Hey, send me her address. I'll be there as soon as I can.
The black cloud around Kelsey has gotten so thick at this point that not even Rhiannon's presence can send it away.
But Stephanie's journal is really serious. You have to stop her.
I don't even know if that deadline is real.
You wouldn't have called me if you believed that.
But is it really my right? It's her own life. I can't interfere with it.
What about Justin? Or Nathan, or any of the ones who skip school or work or family stuff just so you and I can hang out?
That's different, Rhiannon.
So you just let her die because you don't want to get involved? Because she's not me? I won't let you do that.
In my heart, I know she's right.
You don't get to pick and choose whose lives you interfere with.
She needs you.
What can I do? What would I even say?
Make her mom see how much pain she's in. Use your voice to give Kelsey the words she can't find.
That night, I tell Kelsey's mom what must be the hardest words for her to hear.
Mom, I want to kill myself. Please, I really need you to get me some help.
I give her the journal, which might be my biggest betrayal of Kelsey, but I can hear Rhiannon's voice.
Hey, you're doing the right thing.
Why didn't you tell me sooner?
Why didn't you see?
I'm not going to do anything tonight, but in the morning,
Even if I change my mind, please remember this notebook.
Call an ambulance if you have to.
That night, Kelsey's mom paces outside her door, and I fall asleep
to the sound of her concern.
Hey, I called Kelsey's house this morning. Her mom said she's away getting some help, so I think that's a good sign. I'm proud of you.
You can't avoid my questions forever. Reverend Poole says this is the work of the devil.
Check out this link to a news clip about Nathan. National news outlets are picking it up.
The devil walks among us.
There are untold stories of people who claim they have been possessed by the devil. Death row criminals, compromised politicians.
It's a little convenient, wouldn't you say?
Reverend Poole, do you believe Nathan Daldry?
Oh, I have no doubt. It's a textbook example of demonic possession.
If anyone else has experienced this, please contact Reverend Poole. I can't be the only one.
We as a society have left the doors wide open. Why wouldn't the devil walk right in?
If you or a loved one has been affected by demonic possession, please call the number on your screen now.
Confess now, before we find you.
Hey, I have no plans on Saturday. Let's spend the whole day together, just us. Love, Rhiannon.
Rhiannon sends me directions to her uncle's hunting cabin, and Xavier Adams skips rehearsal for his school's production of Hamlet to spend an uninterrupted day with her.
My uncle has a ton of land. We could fish or hike or go kayaking.
I think Xavier is more of a thespian than an outdoorsman.
What if we just stay in and talk?
Okay. So, when did you first know that you were like this?
Maybe at 4 or 5. Obviously, I knew about changing bodies and changing parents every day. But I thought that was just normal.
What made you realize it wasn't?
Weirdly, it was the concept of tomorrow. People kept talking about doing things tomorrow and assuming I'd be there. And I couldn't figure out why they were never actually there like they said they would be.
Did you try to hold on?
For a while.
Yeah.
But eventually I realized it was never gonna change. No matter what, at midnight,
I was switching bodies whether I liked it or not.
How many times have you told this story?
None. I swear. You're the first.
I still don't understand. Why me?
You made me want to rewrite the rules.
We passed the entire night this way. Until the clock strikes 11.
If I don't leave right now, the same thing that happened to Nathan will happen to Xavier, and I can't do that again.
I understand. I do. I'll stay here tonight and wait for you.
Rhiannon, I love you.
I love you too.
I'll be back tomorrow.
I promise.
Here's the thing about promises.
There's no guarantee I can keep them.
Dana?
Where am I?
The hospital. Do you remember anything about last night?
Of course I do. I remember everything about Rhiannon, but I can't seem to find any of Dana's memories.
No, nothing. You had too much to drink at a party. Your friends called us after they wrestled your car keys away from you. The doctor said to pump your stomach.
I fight through the fog of Dana's hangover.
How could you do something like this?
Mom, I'm so sorry, but I really need a computer or a phone.
That's all you have to say to yourself? Mom, I just need to go. I'm so disappointed in you.
I've broken my promise to Rhiannon, and there's nothing I can do about it. The next morning I'm in Valeria, and I'm very late for work as a maid.
An underage, undocumented maid.
I'm assigned to the bathrooms of a $1 million mansion with my sister. After 2 hours, we are done.
But there are 6 houses to go.
And by the time I get back to our cramped apartment that night, I wouldn't have the energy to email again. Even if Valeria was standing foot of order.
Wake up, kiddo! It's time to go to Hawaii!
Aloha!
I accessed and discovered that
the family is off on a week-long vacation for Michael's sister's wedding!
Only for me, it won't be a week. Because in order to get back here, I'd have to wake up in the body of a 16-year-old, also on vacation, who was going home that day. It could take months, weeks.
It might never happen.
The taxi will be here in 45 minutes!
Under no circumstances can I go. This is probably the worst thing I've ever done to someone, but while everyone else is upstairs, I bolt out the front door, find the nearest bus, and head to Rhiannon's school.
Where the hell were you?
Please, I can explain.
I waited all day for you. My uncle and his hunting buddy showed up, but I couldn't even leave because I still thought you were coming and I didn't want you to be alone. It's been 3 days, eh?
I'm sorry. I couldn't get away. Each day I was just trapped. I barely got here today. I had to bail on Michael's family trip to Hawaii. I shouldn't have promised her. We can figure this out.
What the hell?
Justin,
Is this who you've been sneaking around with for the last month?
No, I can't.
It's not what it was. You're not allowed to speak, bro.
Justin, stop it!
Do you love him?
I don't love him! But I don't love you either.
You're such a slut.
We're through.
I'm sorry. I shouldn't have just shown up here like that.
A, this isn't fair.
What do you mean?
You hijacked Michael's life to see me.
But why should his life come before mine? Why shouldn't I be the one who gets to live a little?
Because you're just the guest.
I would end all this changing if I could, just to stay with you.
We both know you can't.
But I love you.
And we both know that's not enough.
I wanted to believe that love could conquer all. But love can't do anything on its own.
It relies on us to do the conquering on its behalf.
You say you're not a demon? Prove it! Why aren't you talking to me? I can't sleep anymore. I keep wondering if you're going to come back. You have to be the devil. Only the devil would leave me like this. Do you have any idea what it's like for me now?
The emails from Nathan have piled up. And when I think about what Rhiannon said to me.
You're just a guest.
My guilt over Nathan becomes overwhelming. So I finally give him what he wants. Nathan?
Do I know you?
In a way.
My name's Kate. Probably
email me at 852-526@gmail.com. Let's sit down. He's so desperate for answers that he doesn't doubt my story at all. My explanation seems right to him. It fits his own experience exactly, but when I'm done, he doesn't know what to say.
So like tomorrow, you're not going to be hurt?
No.
What will she remember?
Enough to fill in the gaps of what happened today, if anyone asks.
She'll never know she wasn't really here.
So why did I know?
Maybe I left you too fast, or I didn't lay the proper groundwork for your memory.
I am sorry about that.
But you can't tell anyone else. Please.
Can I ask one thing more from you? Can we meet up again tomorrow? I just need to see the switch for myself.
I figure I owe him this much, so I tell him I'll try.
Ainsley knows it's afraid of spiders and allergic to peanuts.
Under ordinary circumstances, this would be an ordinary day.
Today is anything but.
So it's really you?
It's really me.
Come in.
I really wasn't planning to stay.
Please, just for a bit.
Okay, I guess.
I'm so glad I finally get the chance to meet you.
Reverend Poole, what are you doing here?
Well, Nathan told me the most interesting story, and I'm wondering if it's true.
Nathan wasn't supposed to tell anyone else.
While you've left Nathan hanging, I've been attempting to give him answers. It's natural that he should confide in me.
I'll go get us some drinks.
I am not the devil
or a demon. I'm just a person who borrows other people's lives for a day.
Relax. You and I are on the same side. Did you never ask yourself why I'm cataloging these occurrences, what I'm looking for? The answer is you and others like you.
There are no others like me.
Of course there are. Look at me.
Something behind her eyes paralyzes me. And I know.
You're not Reverend Poole, are you?
I am today. Tomorrow, who knows? I have to judge what suits me best. Frankly, I'm shocked you still haven't learned how to make it last longer than a day.
That's not possible.
Everyone doubts it until they learn.
So this is something you can teach me?
I promise. You have no idea the power that you possess.
I brought Dr. Pepper.
Think about it, won't you? I'll be in touch.
This is everything I've ever wanted.
A way to stay.
But there's someone dangerous behind your eyes.
Someone who doesn't play by the same set of rules.
There was no hesitation, no warning.
No acknowledgement of the lives you'd be destroying.
And that's why, no matter how much I want to stay, I have to go.
Thanks for agreeing to meet me.
I didn't like the way you left things. I want you in my life, A. I just know that it can't work the way we want it to.
I met them in pool today. She told me there are others out there. Like me.
Wait, what?
There's someone possessing pool right now, and they have been ever since Nathan contacted her.
Apparently it's something I can learn to control.
So, there's a way you might be able to stay.
But you were right. I can't pick and choose whose lives I interfere with.
And if you stay,
someone else's life has to go.
A, if we had met under different circumstances,
she doesn't need to say it. I know. Before I go, I just wanted to thank you.
For what?
Maybe the universe doesn't care about us.
Maybe time doesn't care about us.
But that's why we have to care about each other.
Thank you for showing me what it means. Taught me that every person is a possibility. I think of all these lives I've passed through.
And realize that the world is an enormous place.
When I wake up tomorrow, I don't know where I'll go or what I'll do. But I do know this.
I finally understand why we connect.